Good day everyone, I'm Dr. Usam Ibrahim from Ease and Different Radiology. Today I will talk about specific presentations for phacochromocytoma. First of all, here in Ease and Different Radiology, I'm talking about all things related to radiology diagnosis. So if this is something you are studying and looking to perfect, you have found the right channel. Phacochromocytoma today, I want to talk about the relative diseases, which the phacochromocytoma can be as a part from the syndromes or diseases, as mentioned in the front page. The learning objective from my presentation today is answering of these questions, and I consider these questions as a pearls, because if you can answer these questions, you can know a lot of information about the phacochromocytoma, which you can use it during the real cases or during exam. The first question: if you presented with mass in the adrenal gland, is it phacochromocytoma or other differential diagnosis? If you can differentiate this, you can go to in the right route for reaching the final diagnosis. Second question: if you diagnose disease lesions in the adrenal gland as a phacochromocytoma, what are the clinical parameters raise the possibility of diagnosing of phacochromocytoma? Third question: I will talk about is it sporadic or part of systemic status. You should answer these questions during diagnosing of phacochromocytoma. Is this lesion is only in solitary or sporadic, or part from the systemic status to reaching the final diagnosis and right diagnosis? The fourth question: is it benign or malignant? These lesions, when diagnosing, is it benign or malignant? Or by the other way, is phacochromocytoma can be considered as a malignant lesions or not? I will answer also through the presentations. And last question: do you know phacochromocytoma 10% rule? And I will discuss this at the end of the presentations, which makes summarize of my presentation today. Actually, I know the presentations or talking about phacochromocytoma is slightly confusing. Just follow me with a little bit concentration till the end of the video, and I promise you that we are all together sharing to clear these confusions and the definitions of the diseases related to the phacochromocytoma. So let's get started. I would like to start my presentation by this image. As I see lesion here in the adrenal gland in the post-contrast study, and this is also CT with contrast showing the lesions also in the adrenal gland here with central necrosis, necrotic area. So where is the phacochromocytoma from these lesions, or which one is the phacochromocytoma? To answer these questions, I think you need another helping modalities or studies to confirm the diagnosis of phacochromocytoma and differentiating it from the other lesion, as this lesion is central necrosis. So the differential diagnosis, or the first possibility for differential diagnosis, is the malignancy here, or adrenal cortical cell carcinoma. I think the nuclear medicine here have a role for differentiating phacochromocytoma from the other adrenal carcinoma. And the most familiar one used in the adrenal gland lesions or phacochromocytoma specifically is iodine 123 MIBG. MIBG here, this is the tracer for the isotope, which is called meta-iodobenzylguanidine and labeled by the iodine 123. And these tracers are absorbed by the phacochromocytoma pathological cells, so appearing bright or hotspot in the exam, like this study of the I-123 MIBG, which is showing bilateral absorption of the tracer, as we see here. So this is diagnostic for the phacromycetoma if you diagnose it as an adrenal lesion from the start. There are another tracers of the nuclear medicine also can used, but not familiar like this one, like octreotide somatostatin scan, which can be labeled by Indian 111 or also by iodine tracer. And the third one is the gallium PET-CT, which also have a sensitivity, high sensitivity for diagnosing of the adrenal phacromycetoma by absorption of the tracer and the high standardized uptake value. So this is a nuclear medicine tracers or modalities which can helping differentiating adrenal lesions with central necrosis as a phacromycetoma from the other adrenal cortical carcinoma. So if you return again for our case and the questions, which one is a phacromycetoma? And we have one study of the MIBG study and showing tracer uptake here. This is confirming diagnosing of that lesion is the phacromycetoma, and the other lesion is considered the adrenal carcinoma. Also, you can confirm this by the same study, which is showing no tracer uptake in the case or in the status of the adrenal carcinoma, confirming diagnosing of adrenal carcinoma from phacromycetoma before biopsy or before operation. MIBG has a major role also in the diagnosing of extra-adrenal phacromycetoma. As we know, the adrenal phacromycetoma can occur, however, there are 10% of from the phacromycetoma occurring extra-adrenal, which is called the paraganglioma. And as these lesions, which are appearing in the unenhanced scan of CT, showing lesions adjacent to the spleen, this is the spleen and this is the left kidney, and there are lesions adjacent to the spleen here. These lesions, if there are clinical considerations, there is a possibility of diagnosing of phacromycetoma like hypertension or presence of catecholamines within in the urine. So now you can suspect these lesions as a phacromycetoma. And the examination of a choice here to diagnosing this and confirming diagnosis is the MIBG study, I-123 MIBG, which confirming diagnosing of the a tracer uptake here in the lesions which are present in CT and confirming diagnosing of extra adrenal phacromycetoma and diseases which is called the paraganglioma. So paraganglioma or extra adrenal phacromycetoma also can be helped diagnosed by and confirming diagnosing by the same tracer of MIBG. And as I mentioned in the first of these slides, 10% from the adrenal, from the phacromycetoma can occur the extra adrenal like this lesion. And now we can shift to the other question. What are the clinical parameters that raise the possibility of the phacromycetoma diagnosing? As a patient, if clinically presented by some factors or parameters, can raise the possibility of diagnosing of phacromycetoma. First one and the most important one is the refractory hypertension in young age group, which cannot be diagnosed or cannot be mentioned the cause of the hypertension by the other modalities or other laboratory tests. So refractory hypertension which have unknown cause can be the cause is phacromycetoma in the adrenal gland. And this raises the possibility of diagnosing of phacromycetoma if there are lesions in the adrenal gland in the same patient. The second parameter is clinically is the positive urinary catecholamines, which also if present raise the possibility of diagnosing of phacromycetoma, which need further investigations by CT examination to confirm the presence of lesions at the adrenal gland. And also, retrospectively, if you have lesions in the adrenal gland and you came asking the physicians to for hypertension of that patient or asking to do laboratory test urinary for catecholamines to confirm diagnosing of phacromycetoma or excluding it. So this is the most important clinical parameters which are associated with the phacromycetoma. and also 10% from phacochromocytoma have no hypertension. The most cases of phacochromocytoma associated with hypertension due to elevations of catecholamines level. However, 10% from the phacochromocytoma have no hypertension also. And now with another parameter, is it sporadic or part from systemic status? After you diagnose phacochromocytoma, adrenal lesions as a phacochromocytoma like this adrenal lesions diagnosed by clinical or by laboratory, catecholamines level elevations, hypertension, or by MIPG, by any methods you diagnose it as a phacochromocytoma, you should differentiate is it sporadic or solitary lesion as a phacochromocytoma solitary, or there are multiplicity of the lesions or bilaterality, because 10% also from the phacochromocytoma can be occurred bilateral. And the second question here, or second thing which come in your mind, if there are bilateral phacochromocytoma, is that bilaterality part from another systemic disease like this patient of MEN2 syndrome, MEN2 which is multiple endocrine neoplasia, and this diagnosed as a MEN2 because there are thyroid medullary carcinoma also associated with this lesion. As we will discuss the MEN syndromes in the next slides in details. From these slides, 10% from the phacochromocytoma can occur the bilateral. When you see bilaterality of the phacochromocytoma, which is confirmed here by tracer uptake, MIBG also, you should exclude other possibility of the syndrome as a phacochromocytoma in these situations apart from that syndrome. And now what is the MEN2 syndrome? MEN meaning multiple endocrine neoplasia, and there are MEN1 and MEN2. MEN2 is divided into or subclassified into 2A and 2B. MEN2A is including phacochromocytoma, medullary thyroid cancer, and parathyroid hyperplasia. However, MEN2B have also phacochromocytoma and medullary thyroid cancer, but there are mucosal neuroma and marfanoid habits also. So phacochromocytoma can be part from MEN2A or MEN2B, so you should exclude that by searching and imaging of the thyroid gland and searching for parathyroid hyperplasia by laboratory or by imaging also. Also, phacochromocytoma can be part from the carnitariad. And what is the carnitariad? This is extra-adrenal paraganglioma or phacochromocytoma associated with gastrointestinal tumors like which is called GIST and gastrointestinal stromal tumors and pulmonary chondromas which representing pulmonary nodules with calcifications at the periphery. So if you have phacochromocytoma, you should also excluding the presence of the GIST in the stomach by imaging and presence of chondroma in the pulmonary by CT, for example. So carnitariad also part from the syndromes which associated with phacochromocytoma. Also phacomatosis, all phacomatosis except NF2 have relations with phacochromocytoma like von Recklinghausen disease, which is called NF1. If you have adrenal lesions with neurofibromas, for example, you should consider is a phacochromocytoma at that time part from the syndrome. Von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, for example, if you have hemangioblastoma in the spinal cord or in the posterior fossa of the brain associated with adrenal lesion. Sturge-Weber syndrome, leptomeningeal enhancing and calcification. Tuberous sclerosis, which have subependymal enhancing nodule and giant cell astrocytoma. And now with the next question, is phacochromocytoma benign lesions or malignant lesion? As I mentioned before, the phacochromocytoma can be malignant in the 10% of cases, like this left adrenal phacochromocytoma, which is large lesions and have central necrosis, appearing in this intravenous contrast and oral contrast enhancing CT examination, associated with metastatic nodules which appearing also in the liver at that port to venous phase, which appearing not enhancing. So 10% from pheochromocytoma also can be malignant, like this case. And if pheochromocytoma are malignant, it causing a hypervascular metastasis. Hypervascular metastasis, it's appearing enhancing lesions in the arterial phase. And there are a lot of primary tumors which are causing hypervascular metastasis. And they can be remembered by that mnemonic word MRCT-PET, M from melanoma, R from renal cell carcinoma, CT from choriocarcinoma, T from thyroid tumor or cancer, and PET from pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, which is represented by pancreatic islet cell tumor, pheochromocytoma, our presentation today, pheochromocytoma, and carcinoid part from the breast cancer, about 15% from breast cancer, can also be causing enhancing lesions in the arterial phase, which is called hypervascular metastasis. So pheochromocytoma, when become malignant or considered malignant, it causing hypervascular metastasis also. At the end, this slide is considered a summarizing for my presentation. Do you know pheochromocytoma 10% rule? 10% rule of pheochromocytoma is 10% from pheochromocytoma is considered extra-adrenal, like case which I introduced or presented here in the presentation as a lesions beside or adjacent to the spleen. Also, extra-adrenal lesions can occur as a para-aortic lesion. So if there are para-aortic nodules associated with hypertension and elevation of catecholamine, you should consider it a pheochromocytoma or paraganglioma in the Zucker candle gland. 10% from pheochromocytoma are bilateral. Most of them is unilateral. However, there are 10% is bilateral. And when bilateral, you should exclude the presence of other disease like phacomatosis, von Recklinghausen disease, von Hippel-Lindau, tuberous sclerosis, Sturge-Weber, or Carnegie triads, main type 2A or main type 2B, or associated with pheochromocytoma when it is bilateral in 10%. 10% from them are malignant, and if it is malignant, you should consider hypervascular metastasis. And the causes of hypervascular metastasis can memorized by the name MRCT-PET, as I mentioned in the previous slide. 10% from pheochromocytoma occurring in children, however, most of them occurring in adult group. 10% are familial, and 10% have no hypertension. And at the end, 10%, as this image showing calcifications, most of cases have no calcifications. However, this case is pheochromocytoma showing peripheral or mural calcifications here. It appearing only in 10% of cases. I hope this lesson helped to make a few things clearer for you. And if you have any questions, you can pop it easily in under the video, and I will try to answer it as soon as possible. You can invite also for my Facebook group by the same name, Is a Different Radiology. Or you can watch more than 80 presentations in the my channels in the YouTube by searching in Google search by the same name, Is a Different Radiology. Or wait me every Wednesday, Sunday, and Friday for new presentation. Thank you very much for watching, listening, attention, and goodbye.